Right, so I think that the fact that this YouTube channel exists is basically enough proof of me having at least one major fuck-up in my life in order to have it turn this way. Fuck-ups are the way that life teaches you lessons by beating you mercilessly into the ground until you're basically forced to either quit or stand up and prepare yourself for the next strike. Unless you're me, and the only reason that you still stand up is because you rapped the Real Slim Shady back in middle school and you're basically forced to comply to what society has set for you. I would honestly like to solve my problems by taking myself out. As I said, nobody is free from fuck-ups, and fuck-ups will come and get you, regardless of how successful or skillful you are. Nowhere is this more evident than in the gaming industry. No single developer is exempt from being criticized, and if you're knowledgeable enough, you'd be able to pinpoint the most significant fuck-ups corresponding to their career. The problem is that those are the developers that survive the scrutiny as a result of their success. What everybody seems to forget is that not all of those fuck-ups led to survival and recovery, but to the downright downfall of otherwise great ideas and concepts that were in development. For every major EA loot box scandal that pops up in the news, rocking the planet to its very core, there's one mighty number 9 that somehow manages to slip under the radar of notorious fuck-up cases. The only reason that people know about them is because there was a final product release for game reviewers to put at the number 1 spot of worst or most bland game for that year. In all honesty, would anyone regard games like Ride of Hell, Retribution, and Day 1 Gary's Incident with the infamous recognition that they hold today if it weren't for the famous critics? Well, it could be a bit of a stretch to go on either side of the spectrum, but at least there was something to discuss. With the game I decided to cover for today, the final product wasn't even released, making the whole was it a fuck-up stigma even more complicated to pin down. Am I starting to sound a bit too smart? Sorry, I caught myself in a brief period of enlightenment making educated guesses about discussion statements rather than getting to what we're actually meant to be talking about here and making self-loathing haha jokes. I'm pretty sure that everyone and their mother must be familiar with Hotline Miami 1 and 2 by the time that I'm releasing this, but for anyone who is ignorant enough or unable to get them, they are top-down shooters of excellent quality. You can look up the gameplay on YouTube for yourself since it's too simplistic and unrelated to the topic currently at hand for me to review right now, but might in the future. What will take you some time to comprehend is the story. It's extremely convoluted and confusing, which is why it's better for you to play it yourself rather than googling an answer for it, because it makes any interpretation you have for it be more meaningful than what actually happens. This is done through the brilliant use of multiple protagonists, unreliable narrators, and metaphors for meanings that can be broad but specific enough for you to pinpoint something of value. It's also kind of ironic considering that the game is set in the late 80s and early 90s with bright neon colors, pixel graphics, an orgasmically good soundtrack, and a fetish for animal masks is the one that teaches me the very real coldness, aggression, passion and desensitized stoicness of the real world more than most life experiences I've ever had. Regardless of how well Hotline Miami 1 and 2 did, however, some people felt that all the mysterious loose ends were tied too quickly and abruptly during the second game's ending. I won't spoil it because, unlike other games whose endings I spoil with no regards about the people who watch these sorts of videos, it has an actual meaning beyond killing is bad or revenge is good, deserving some sort of critical analysis. However, after finishing the second game in hard mode and after sitting through the credits, there is a fake teaser ending screen promoting Hotline Miami 3. It was later confirmed by the devs to be some sort of joke or easter egg, possibly for the then upcoming level editor feature, but it told everyone that Hotline Miami 3 would not be a thing. The story had wrapped up, and there was no need to officially continue it. I'd argue that this was a smart move by the developers, seeing as how third installments reach levels of mythical nowadays because they never release, and if they do, they fail to meet the expectations of even the most loyal of supporters. The problem is that the universe on which Hotline Miami is set is so interesting that despite the ending being the one thing that was meant to stop everything for good and is the best option to end it with, it still leaves you wanting more. After the level editor was released, people could make their own stories related to the game's plot, but were limited to using existing assets or modifying them to change their appearance. There wasn't anything new gameplay-wise, and it seemed that the game was going to hit the dirt for good. That's when mods and fan games started to appear. I'm personally not very familiar with many Hotline Miami fan games, but there's one in particular that everyone's heard of, and part of that success is due to the major fuck-up related to it. The product in question is Midnight Animal. Somewhere around late 2015, a gentleman by the name of Spencer Yan made a bold statement by promising a total conversion mod of Hotline Miami with a possible continuation of how the story would have unfolded had it continued until the present day. This wasn't too different to any other mod's premises, but this one had the approval of Denetin Games, the developers themselves. I myself remember seeing this on ModDB around the time it was announced, and I have to admit that I was somewhat amazed at how promising it looked. It later got a trailer, and it was exactly what every bloodthirsty fan of the original had wanted. Gameplay that looked like the original and was expanded upon, blood being spilled everywhere, and the amazing orchid by Disco Death in the background gave that cathartic feeling that only a game like Hotline Miami could bring, only multiplied by a lot more. Eventually, Midnight Animal made its way into Steam and was successfully greenlit in March of 2016, making it seem like this would be the definitive Hotline Miami fan game, with none being able to top it. Even a completely pessimistic realist cunt like me began to feel somewhat excited for Midnight Animal's future, mostly because it was developed by this one guy out of passion, even if he was planning to charge for it, which I don't remember if he was going to, but for what it was, it still seemed pretty sweet. Still, I couldn't help but feel skeptical, because the release date was set on August of the same year, and it seemed like a bit of a stretch for a project of the magnitude of Midnight Animal, but who knows, maybe Spencer had been working on it for some time, so I decided to stay positive for once and follow the development closely to see what would happen. After some time, the project was put on hold. If I remember correctly, on June 2016, Spencer said that he would put the project on hold indefinitely due to personal problems. It seemed like a reasonable excuse. I mean, outside of our online accounts, we all have necessities and issues we have to tend to. The community was understanding and supportive of Spencer, showing levels of maturity that are surprising for people on the fucking internet nowadays. No matter how well everyone treated the situation, the project seemed like it was dead in the water. There was no word from Spencer for months, resulting in many losing their faith in the project as it began to seem like it had gone vaporware and destined to suffer from Half-Life 3 syndrome, but everyone understood because life problems were involved. Around that time, Midnight Animal's page had a small demo you could download as a preview of how the game would play once the rest was released. Try finding it nowadays, and the most you'll ever get is gameplay footage of it on YouTube. I haven't been able to find it after the whole debacle went down, but fortunately, I somehow discovered a hidden copy of it on my old laptop that I used at the time. Shit, that must have been some mad foresight. I had no idea I'd need this more than 2 years down the line. So anyways, you boot this son of a bitch up and... Would you look at that title screen? This is perfect. If you know how Hotline Miami 2 ended, then you know that this follows up perfectly, at least thematically. Well, there's not much else that we can do here, since the only options are start and exit, and unlike my life, I'm not willing to just give up before starting, so let's play the game. I adore this. This is how you introduce your game, goddammit. I mean, when you think of good game intros nowadays, one of the best examples that comes to mind is Doom 2016. This is not as god tier as that, but it's still fucking amazing. Let's face it, if you're playing this, you already know what Hotline Miami is and how it plays, so it doesn't bother to explain anything to you. Screen lights up, you hear that kick-ass music coming up, you see you're in New York, it's raining like a motherfucker, and there's dudes walking about in a Chinese joint with guns. You know damn well what you're supposed to do. The gameplay is excellent. It feels like classic Hotline Miami gameplay, but it's still distinct. Shooting and killing enemies feels sublime. The sound effects, paired along with how the screen shakes with every shot and kill, make this demo feel punchier than the original game, and that's quite important too, because Hotline Miami was all about fast-paced combat, racking up as many kills as possible, and catharsis, and that's still here. Enemies are faster and more responsive than in the original game, which can take some time to get used to, but I think it adds a nice bit of challenge and is an overall strength rather than a hindrance. There's also multiple weapons you can try, just to showcase the potential variety this game could have had in that department. You can also see some experimentation on Spencer's part regarding the awesome but impractical C4, the grenade launchers, and the intentionally vague story that's hinted at to be continued at the end. All in all, despite being one level and a bit buggy, I still think that this is what a Hotline Miami sequel should do. I'd encourage you to play it, but I'm the only one that has this file, so yeah, tough shit. I'd put it up for download, but I'm afraid that Spencer would smite me if I did, after all, it's his game. Regardless, this version of the game would be bound to change soon enough. Against all odds, Midnight Animal's Steam page saw an update on February 2017, after 8 months of silence. Just when I was ready to claim that Spencer had made a promise that he could never keep, the game gave signs of life again. I checked the Steam page, read all the text and things that had been changed, and began to think that maybe my initial claim wasn't too far off from the truth. Midnight Animal had changed drastically. As a matter of fact, it was now called Midnight Animal, A Story of Love and Forgetting. The core gameplay would no longer be focused on the usual fast-paced, frantic violence of Hotline Miami, but on roleplay with heavy emphasis on visual novel and life simulation elements. I should mention that the aspect of combat was still supposed to be there, but secondary to the new stuff that was introduced. Besides core gameplay changes, the plot where 50 Blessings had taken control over the US in a contemporary setting was dropped in exchange for what many called an anime dating sim. This did not go well with the fans at all. people were fucking enraged. Not even the most positive people who reacted were happy. Hell, for once, I felt like I was the only one who had anything positive to say about something while everyone else was lampooning this game. I thought that as long as the combat was included and improved upon like Spencer had promised, I'd give the story a shot and see if the change was detrimental. That wouldn't last. Less than a year later, Spencer announced that Midnight Animal was officially cancelled. This was met with, again, a negative reaction from an angry and disappointed crowd. This situation shows how a lack of communication can completely destroy a project. The main issue I see with Midnight Animal's conception and release is how Spencer neglected to inform anyone about the changes he would introduce to his creation. Based on this Indie Hellzone article that's my main source of info for stuff that I can't remember about the situation, Spencer had a Patreon funding this thing and none of the backers were informed about the change. So, with the project cancelled, I was ready to move on to other prospects. 2 years later, I suddenly remember about this fiasco and decided to make this video as a sort of cautionary tale to reflect upon the entire thing, but something unexpected came to my attention while I was finding more info. The Indie Hellzone article mentions that Spencer had apparently released two other projects after Midnight Animal's cancellation, one being what I assume was to be the game he would have released had he completed A Story of Love and Forgetting. It's titled The Exegesis of John the Martyr, and it's interesting. This is what Spencer envisioned when he thought of a visual novel. Exegesis still retains a top-down view from Hotline, but has absolutely no combat at all. As a matter of fact, this is a complete 180 from what Hotline Miami is like. Your movements are slow, the bright neon color palette is replaced with a dark, realistic, and atmospheric ambience, and there's tons of dialogue. Oh. So. Many. Lines. Of dialogue. I'm not gonna lie, as someone who writes in his spare time, I can totally see where this idea stems from. I actually like the mysteriousness of the whole thing. I like the setting's atmosphere of a dark and depressing city that's run by a mysterious organization. I like how eerily out of place the convenience store feels and the music that plays while you're in it, and I like the tone with which everything is presented. The biggest problem here is, again, the massive walls of text that Spencer passes off as dialogue. They seem unnatural, not in a way that complements the other aspects of the story. Spencer is really wordy, and this dialogue just highlights how he sometimes can't help himself. Moving on from that, the other game that he released is The Document of Midnight Animal. This is what supporters of the original project were looking for, but sadly, this is not a complete product either. Document is more of a post-mortem homage of Midnight Animal. It's not what it promised to be, nor it intends to, but it tries something different to what was offered in the demo. Also, like the demo, people on YouTube are showcasing a game that's completely different from what I got from downloading the zip from Spencer's webpage. Whether that's just due to it being updated sometime before I wrote this, or me just being a fucking idiot, the differences still exist. While the version that people show on YouTube is much more similar to the demo, the one I got could be considered an entirely different game. I boot up the game and am greeted to the wonderful nihilistic advice from my man Nietzsche. Ah, now that's just great. More reminders for my inherent overall uselessness in this world. Spencer, you man of culture! Though you may want to proofread the words of the great Nietzsche there, buddy. Anyways, Document has a couple of levels that you can play with no particular order or setup in mind. As I said, this is more of a what-if than an actual product. Sadly, most of them don't work, and the couple few ones that do are very flimsy and prone to crashing, so I'll give my criticisms based on how little of it I could actually experience. Okay, first of all, I have to get something out of the way. This soundtrack is actually killing me. I'm not gonna play it because my copyright, but it's something that really irks the game the wrong way. I'm not trying to say that the tracks are bad, not at all. My inner 2000s panic fan is screaming like a little girl, but it just doesn't fit well with the tone of the game. There's something about the presentation of the violent gameplay and the rhythm of the songs that make them feel out of place. That or maybe I just can't stand playing games while listening to music with lyrics, I don't know, that probably contributes too. First of all, movement has been slowed down, probably a necessity for all of the new mechanics that Spencer added. Enemies now have health, and although they can still go down easily, they can be hard to dispatch in groups. Let a couple of them gang up on you and expect to meet a quick death. Oh, but what's that? You also have a health meter to soak up bullets! In addition to that, you can also reload most guns, rendering you with an unlimited supply of bullets, and press G to throw grenades instead of the C4 from the previous demo. You still have an infinite supply of them, so feel free to spam them until you terraform the entire fucking city, I guess. Grenades and bullets seem to be a bit unstable, though. Your shots won't always hit your target, even if you're directly in front of them, and grenades will often bounce in ridiculous and unexpected angles. The inclusion of all these diverse combat elements, in addition to the melee and execution mechanics, make me think that there was an attempt to try and introduce a more dynamic system of combat. You know, strategically planning out an attack in contrast to going in and just fucking flapping your baseball bat dick around so everyone dies. Aside from that, you have a dash and teleporting ability now at your disposal, and I like both of these, but there's something about it that just doesn't click. There's no consequence to freely spamming these abilities, so it can make encounters with enemies a complete cakewalk. If there were any new obstacles or enemies to complement the teleportation and dash abilities, it could work seamlessly, but that's just something that simply can't be done with vanilla oddly my Andy's design, I feel. I want this to work, but I'm torn on it. See, the ideas were good, but the execution is far from perfect. A good example of this is the hard, punchy feeling of the demo. Since the cathartic feeling of killing an enemy was invoked oh so well with the screen shake in the demo, it was amplified here in Document, but it's just too much. Your screen is flashing constantly with glitchy messages and error screens, and while it was a novel idea, it quickly outstays its welcome. Activate an explosive of any kind or get ganged on and you could very well suffer from a seizure. Hey, hang on. What just happened? Why did my character change? And most importantly, why does it feel like I'm playing an entirely different game now? Apparently, pressing 1, 2, 3, and 0 on the keyboard can change the character you're playing as. The character you start with is the one you get when you press 0, and he's the one that's as close to the original Masked Murderer gameplay we all know and love. Pressing 1 will let you play as this game's version of Tony from Hotline 2. The only tangible difference is that his punches aren't lethal, much like Evan, and money drops from enemies when you punch them. Pressing 2 will turn you into a SWAT riot officer, complete with a shield, concussion grenades, and a taser gun. Police assault in progress, huh? Yeah, it's an assault, alright.
Major terrorist operation going down in the vaguely Asian district. Dispatch, send in like one guy.
Who the hell do you think you are? Payday 2?
Oh, we'll get to that one later.
This SWAT officer may be my least favorite of the playable characters. He's slow and clunky, and all his weapons simply suck at killing enemies. Seriously, the time it takes you to kill one guy is just long enough for you to get railed on. The third character is a more artistic one than the others. Selecting him will cause all colors to become monochromatic except for the color red, a la Sin City or the Russell mask from the original Hotline Miami. Your only weapons are a revolver with 5 shots and some ninja star thing, whatever. Oh, and speaking of the original Hotline Miami, you also get to use enemies as human shields if you knock them over by pressing the mouse wheel. So that's the gist of Document. It's a sad thing to look at, honestly. There's good ideas here that just couldn't work because they weren't fleshed out. The more strategic gameplay that could have come from adding health bars, the SWAT character, and the myriad of weapons that don't work in the gallery could have honestly been such a great thing to experience had the project been completed. But why wasn't it completed? To answer that, we have to look at the man behind the project, Spencer Yan. The man had originally created Midnight Animal out of passion, with the full intention of making something amazing that would reciprocate his feelings for what made him feel good in the original games. Behind the scenes, however, things weren't going too hot. The personal problems Spencer had cited during the development hiatus were a breakup, a crisis he suffered after not being able to handle the success of his own project, and failing his first semester at college. It was playing Persona 4 that had led Spencer to continue working on the project, with him stating that the game had made him reflect upon his work. It made him think profoundly, in ways that made him feel ashamed of his old work, and so he attempted to better himself and, in his eyes, improved his project. That's when a story of love and forgetting hit the scene, to the dismay of both Hotline Miami fans and Persona fans alike. While Spencer viewed his work as a homage to both games, the Hotline Miami crowd viewed it as a travesty that would not deliver the story they had wanted. Persona fans, on the other hand, saw that Spencer had traced some Persona artwork and were absolutely furious about it. Two different groups were attacking Spencer for two completely different reasons for what he believed would be an improvement over his initial demo. That's when he broke. That's when this game died. While many people just covered this story in order to tell what happened, I want to add some stuff to it to hopefully not just repeat what I have already said about it. This is my open letter to Spencer. The guy was 18 when he started working on a project of this magnitude. The fact that he was able to produce this demo is absolutely amazing to me. I am 19 right now and I've barely managed to impress anyone on this stupid website. Hell, I can't even ride a fucking bicycle at 19 years of age, goddammit. But here comes this kid, who with the purest intentions in his heart comes to give us a mod for one of the best games of 2015 and fucking nails it to a T. And you're telling me that the simple design choice ended the entire thing? It's his project for
Christ's sake.
Maybe the persona tracing was a bit too much, but otherwise he had absolute power over where the project was heading and how it would all change.
There are ways to settle creative differences, and while Spencer may have not known how to handle it, he got completely demolished for changing something he was in the right to.
Before the entire fiasco went down, Spencer had the hopes of graduating college and becoming a programmer at a great game company. He ended up coming out of it depressed and with his reputation tarnished beyond belief. Nowadays, you can't mention him without bringing up Midnight Animal, the unmentionable failure that made him infamous. He's forced to scour the seams of the internet under different aliases in order to not be recognized as the one dude who screwed up Midnight Animal. I understand that kind of struggle, and I'm sure many others do too. I mean, who hasn't had their doubts? Who hasn't failed at something despite having put an incredible amount of effort onto it? Who hasn't questioned everything they've done until that point?
I sure have. It's the main reason that this filth you see here exists in the first place.
Here's where I want to tie up the initial theme I brought up at the beginning of the video with this one under one nice little bow. Nobody. Nobody is exempt from fucking up. We all need to learn that. However, it is up to us to improve ourselves and not let our failures define us. Spencer can choose to be the Midnight Animal guy whose hopes and dreams were crushed by a crowd who had defined his game for him, or he can grow and become somebody else.
I heard you were working on a new project, Spencer. Good luck on that, pal.
While you are growing and improving, I'll be here getting more and more depressed about my own shitty channel until something happens, like a fade into obscurity or giving myself in to another horrible game review. Speaking of which... This SWAT officer may be the least favorite of the player characters. He's slow and chunky. I said chunky. Fucking kill me. As I... Oh, Jesus. I don't know what's wrong with me. I just hit record and I started laughing. What was I supposed to say? Fuck. Oh god.
Ah, that's just great. More inherent reminders. Fucking hell. Ah, now that's just great. More reminders for my inherent overall uselessness in this world.
Spencer, you man of culture! Ow, my fucking hand. Ugh.